Hi, Maria Liebecker here with Healing You. Do you plan outings with your kids? Ones that you both put time and energy into choosing what you'll be doing together and what you're really looking forward to experiencing? Has anything unexpected ever happened in the midst of those special times? If so, how did you react in the moment? Were you able to stay flexible and adaptable? Or does unpredictability simply knock you way off balance? I remember I've enjoyed planning outings with my youngest son, Rylan. We did that fairly regularly when he was younger. We often folded them right into our homeschooling program. I remember one Monday, we planned to go shopping for his winter coat after we'd gone to another appointment. And this day, it was particularly exciting because we were going to go to the Valley Mall to do the shopping. So let me share the story with you of how that unfolded. I remember Rylan took my hand in his as we crossed the parking lot to enter the mall. And as we went through those big doors, he gave me a big grin and he said, "I love you, Mom." I gave his hand a squeeze and affirmed, "I love you too, son." And as we, as we walked about and looked around, it was very clear that we were not in a familiar place. This mall was set up very differently from the downtown mall that we usually shopped at. Rylan was super keen, though, on navigating, and he took the lead to find the men's winter coats. All along the way, it was the holiday season, so he would stop and he'd look at the decorations that were already set up to capture the shopper's attention. There were so many things to see and take in. Well, when we finally made our way through the maze to the upper floor where the coats were, I could see the disappointment on his face. His brow furrowed and his lips pressed together. And he took in a calming breath to steady himself. He said, "Well, there isn't too much to choose from here now, is there?" His eyes started to dart to another rack. And he moved to take a closer look. "Oh, here, this one. I want this one." So naturally, I said, "Well, would you be willing to try it on, see how it fits you?" As I was pulling the coat off the rack and off the hanger, he took off his jacket and slipped into the winter coat, and he looked at the arm length. "Well, this will last a while." And then suddenly his eyes widened as his face flushed and he pulled the jacket off quickly. He said, "I'm too hot. I'm having a hot flash. Get this off of me." I quickly helped him to get untangled from the coat. I said, "What's going on? Did something not feel right?" He said, "I'm just too hot." Then his eyes landed on some stocking caps on the next aisle, and he moved to look at them. I was still kind of stuck at the coat. I said, "So you'd like to get this coat then?" I was so puzzled. I was watching him move from one item to another, and I noticed his movements. They were getting more agitated. He responded, he goes, "Yes, no, I don't know, Mom." And he had a mounting sense of panic. He said, "I don't know what to do." And when he moved to the end of the aisle, he sank down onto the floor. He said, "I'm just too dang hot all of a sudden. I can't stand it." I quickly moved over to his side. And at the same time, I felt this mounting concern as my gut clenched and the tenseness in my neck. And there was a deep sense of sadness that accompanied this really fleeting thought of, "Oh no, we were having such a good time." So I was kind of unconscious in that moment, and I moved straight to strategy in an attempt to divert the pain in the moment, because it was painful. And I said, "Oh, come on, buddy, let's just go look at a different store then. It'll help to get outside where it's cooler." His face just contorted with pain. and it flushed with the wave of emotion he was feeling in his body. He's like, "Don't touch me." I backed up. He sprang to his feet and he reached out to hug me tight as he whispered fiercely, "Stop it, Mom. You're embarrassing me." Well, this felt to me like it was happening so quickly. I took a deep breath to calm my own spirit as I hugged him back. And I said, "It's okay, Rylan," as I whispered. "I just don't know what to do right now to support you. What can I do?" His fingers began to clench my arms really tightly in this distress. And he goes, "Just stop being so loud. When you do that, people look at me." Well, when I felt the grasp of his fingers tightening, I had my own trigger, an implicit wave of overwhelm washed over me, and I pulled away frantically myself from his grasp. I said, "That hurts my arms. Stop that." Oh, so in that moment, he was stunned and frightened by my outburst, and he darted under the coat rack for safety. I could hear him crying and talking quietly to himself. But again, I jumped straight to strategy in a desperate effort to regain solid ground under my feet. And I demanded, "Rylan, come out here right now. We need to leave." He said, "I can't. I just need to find a white shirt and you aren't helping me." And I thought to myself, "What? A white shirt? Are you kidding me?" In that moment, I was just stretched beyond my window of tolerance. And I grabbed my phone and I started to dial my older son. Rylan could see me from inside that coat rack. And he said, "Who are you calling?" And I was very matter of fact because I was shifted into my functional brain. I was just being matter of fact. I said, "I'm calling Jeremy so you can talk to him." He says, "Oh no, don't call him, please." I was flabbergasted and totally confused. And inside, I could hear myself trying to make sense of all of this. I mean, what is happening? He hasn't done this in years. I don't know what to do. Oh, I need help. I just want to go home, but he's way too big to pick up and carry out of the store anymore. And in that instant, a part of me fell into a well of despair, and I stared into space as I felt my body cave. And I said, "I can't deal with this." And through that fog in my mind, I could hear my son crying out to me, "Don't give up on me, Mommy. Please. You said you'd never give up on me." Well, mirror neurons, they allow the brain to detect the intentions of another person, which enabled Rylan to perceive my emotions and automatically and unconsciously create that state inside of himself. Well, my heart broke wide open as I took in his internal state. And in a heartbeat, I was back, fully present. The cry of my child resonated within me with intensity. Without hesitation, I got down on all fours and I crawled under that coat rack to be with him right where he was. And it didn't matter what anybody else in that store thought. To feel another's experience requires we attune to one another's primary emotions. And resonance can take place when we align our internal states, our primary emotions, through the sharing of nonverbal signals. And this is the way our minds become linked. And it's the basis for empathy. Remember, I reached out to tenderly wipe his tears. I said, "Sweetheart, I'm so sorry. I'm here now. I won't give up on you." He was crying. He was still scared to believe that he wasn't utterly alone. He said, "Well, it felt like you did." And being able to then be really present emotionally, I finally was able to offer an empathy guess. And I said, "I wonder if it felt like being I said, I wonder if it felt like the bottom dropped out of the world. And it's scary when you think no one's there. He held my eye case with his as he nodded. And then he once again took my hand in his gently. And I told him honestly, honey, I was just so overwhelmed and confused. I simply didn't know what to do. I'm back now. Will you forgive me? Time stood still for a long moment as we hugged under that coat rack. And after a while, I peeked out through those coats and I pointed and I said, hey, look over there. I think I see something white. I used to looking for something white. Do you want to be the leader? And I'll follow you wherever you'd like to go. How's that sound? He responded with wonder. Really? And as I nodded, I could hear joy grow in his voice. And he's like, oh, Katie, thanks, Mom. You're the best. I love you, Mommy. I said, I love you too, Snookins. We both crawled out from under that coat rack with big grins, wet eyes, and connected hearts. We're once again ready for an adventure. You know, I marvel that how we communicate with our children has such a profound impact on how they experience an inner sense of security. Being able to respond flexibly is one of the biggest challenges I've ever experienced being a parent. And it does require an inner sense of security to be able to pull it off. When parents join with their child's emotional states, reflecting back to their child, their experience with resonant empathy. Children experience an attuned connection of resonance. And these moments of joining provide a child the experience to feel that they exist within the mind of the parent and to know without a doubt how much they matter. Joining with our children in attuned communication supports them to develop an integrated, and coherent story of their lives. If you want to develop or strengthen your capacity to respond flexibly, reach out to me at healingyoursanctuary.com. And thanks for being on this journey with me today. Healing you.